Welcome to the Cash Bar. How are you, Diane?
I'm doing great. How are you, Ben?
I'm doing all right. My lady friend left town last week to go to her native Colombia, which then, because the Colombians are excellent when it comes to comic timing, Colombia then descended into fucking madness.
Why?
The same reasons we're descending into madness. They've had they're having COVID strikes because everybody's out of work, so they're having just massive civil upheaval over that. They're very upset about the Venezuelans pouring across the border, and they're tearing the whole place apart. Like, she was sending me videos of just full on smashing storefronts, tipping over buses. Like, it's an absolute madhouse, and they're on like full lockdown. Not like our suggested American style. Like, it'd really be nice if you guys would just stay home and do the right thing. Like, they're full on police enforced. Be in your home by 8 p.m. Do not come out on the weekend. You can only be in public if your documents, like your driver's license or your identification numbers, have the certain number for that day for you to be out. Yeah. So it's like, it's super, super strict, but really fucking scary. Like, she sent me these videos and was like, who's taking these videos? Are you taking these videos? She's like, no, they're from the news. Like, calm down, relax.
You're like, get your ass back in the house.
Like, what the fuck are you doing there?
What a fun little vacay for her.
Yeah, I'm sure she's really enjoying it.
Jesus Christ. So sorry. That's so stressful.
It's so weird because I was thinking, just like, okay, she's going to be gone for 2 weeks. So my whole focus is just don't spin off the planet. Like, give yourself something to do, have some projects. Don't go all to shit, Ben. And then I guess start seeing all of this. I'm just like, okay, I'm just going to be wound up in a ball of worry for the next week or two.
Okay. May I suggest some breathing techniques or some yoga?
It's the only thing that's going to get you through a South American class riot.
You just got to connect with your breathing, Ben. It's going to be fine.
It's going to get you through some civil upheaval, balancing the mind and spirit. That's the only thing that's going to get you through.
Your chakras are not in line right now.
How could you tell? You're throwing a garbage can through a window. All right. fair comment. Hey, we have a great guest today. He is a local Houston boy originally. He now makes his home in New York. He is well on his way. He's been on Conan. He's been on Fallon. He's been on the Comedy Central roasts of just about everybody. He's in the forthcoming Billy Crystal movie. I can't wait to ask him about Billy Crystal, my comedy hero. Ladies and gentlemen, Matthew Broussard.
Well, hello. Thank you for having me. Here we are.
I'm looking right into your closet. I'm so nosy.
it's our office closet, you know. It's our backup closet. We're doing okay. How are y'all?
Good. Doing pretty good. We're making it through. Thanks for joining us. How's New York City today?
I'm a little sweaty, yeah, but happening.
Okay.
This is an exciting moment for you because is this your first movie coming out soon, or have you been in another one?
First movie to appear in theaters, yes.
Ooh, big deal. So, yeah, Billy Crystal, right? What's it called? Yeah. Billy Crystal and Tiffany Haddish, right? What's it called?
Here Today comes out May 7th.
Oh, congratulations, man. That's so
Billy
exciting.
Billy Crystal is what got me like interested in stand-up, watching him host the Academy Awards when I was a kid, when I was like 10 or 11. Like, I totally fell in love with Billy Crystal. I just love what he could do with a crowd.
He's a delightful in person. I can attest.
Oh, that's good to hear.
It was really great to work with. He directed it as well and was very attentive to the actors. I was one of the newer actors on set, and he made me feel competent. one of the egos of actors is probably the last thing that should concern you when you're writing and starring in and directing a movie, and he made sure I didn't feel out of place, and I appreciate that. And
I would have needed a lot of that.
Yeah.
I would have been like, am I doing okay? Like, to an annoying amount where they'd be like, just fire her.
I played basically Colin Jost. It's a fictional SNL in the world, and the other, so Billy's intimidating, but the other actors who played the other cast members were all decorated Broadway current or alum. Alex Reitman, I did scenes with, is Beetlejuice on Beetlejuice.
That That was so great. I was front row center for that. Oh my God, he's also hilarious.
He's hilarious. He was also in, he was Jack Black's character in School of Rock on Broadway. And then Sara Stiles, who I'm in the trailer with, is, I believe, Tootsie in Tootsie. And as now making more, so that's very intimidating to be around. I've had far, far less acting experience. I'm mostly a stand-up, so
yeah.
No pressure.
But a lot of pressure.
I wouldn't be able to get to sleep the night before if I'm really like, okay, you're meeting Billy Crystal tomorrow. Like, you're meeting Billy because presumably you had to like read for him or you know, meet him to get his approval for the role. Or I have no idea how the process
auditioned, so. I skipped straight to the, I missed the original audition. So my agent was like, oh, we'll just send you straight to callbacks. I'm like, well, why didn't you do that all along? And my first audition was with him. Yeah, my first audition was with him and Alan Zweibel, who wrote the movie. And I was very nervous in the room, and it went well enough that they cast me, but it was cool just to have auditioned for him, and I didn't expect to book the role.
Well, congratulations, man. I'm so excited for you.
Thank you.
You've come a long way from winning Houston's Funniest Person 2012, Matthew.
Yes. still one of the best moments of my life. It was a great moment.
You won it like twice that year. You won Houston's Funniest Person, and then there was another competition that same year, and you won that one as well.
I did, like a month later. Yeah. I think Don Learned just pushed me through. I don't know. I think he just liked me, and it was like, I'll just make him the winner.
No, I was there, man. You had good sets, and you beat out a lot of old pros in Houston who kind of thought they had in the bag. So it was kind of a sweet moment.
Now I get to get beat out by the Young Bucks. Yeah.
All right, so we asked you which song you wanted to do, and you gave up some really, really good options, but we settled on You Can Call Me Al by Paul Simon. Do you want to tell us why you picked this?
Yes, so I like the song. It's just a very catchy song, and Spotify does lyric analysis of some of the songs, and I happened to catch that one and realize the backstory. The lyrics are very compelling, very personal, and something I can connect with, but I think something most people connect with, the sense of irrelevancy and the sense of feeling you're growing old, especially as an artist. And that's why I really like the song even more than they did.
Yeah. I was kind of struck by how much older Paul Simon is than he was in my brain. Like I had Paul Simon as being like one of those like mid-70s sort of folk rockies. Like I figured he was like a contemporary of like James Taylor. But when I started poking around in his life a little bit more, it's like, oh no, he's 10 or 15 years older than those guys. Like, this guy's a hippie. He's a contemporary of Bob Dylan. I'd never thought of that before.
That's what I'll probably think about.
Yeah. I'm probably the last person to make that comparison, because in all the reading I did, they're just like, oh yeah, Paul Simon is the only person who could potentially rival Dylan's legacy. I'm like, he can? Oh, yeah, he can.
I think it was 23 Billboard singles or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Oh my God.
Just, yeah, long career. There's weird stuff like that. Like Bon Jovi has had more hit singles than Aerosmith. And Billy Joel is also another one where you're like, he had retro sounding music, but it was the 80s. So he's like a contemporary of Poison. You know, Billy Joel has that like, you know, Uptown Girl, which is, I think, mid 80s. It's not that old. Yeah.
Right.
It just sounds like the Motown era.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, I remember that video very well. This song, in high school, I became a huge Simon and Garfunkel fan, but then I kind of didn't follow too much of Paul Simon on his own here and there. And then when I met Corbin, who's now my husband, he's a huge Paul Simon fan. So he learned me the way he learns me with Elvis. I don't know why Corbin isn't 4,000 years old. He knows music that he shouldn't know. But none of us knew the story behind this song and the deeper story of the whole Graceland album and him. I didn't know the details about him going to South Africa and them not wanting him there because they were having a boycott boycotting South Africa because of apartheid. And I was just like, oh shit, I was not paying attention to that when the song was out. All I knew was that Chevy Chase was in the video for some reason. I still don't get that move. After knowing everything I know about the song and the Graceland album and everything about South Africa, I'm like, So let's make the video with Chevy Chase, huh? Good.
Well, I think I thought I was the last person to get the joke, but I really think that it is like that video is obviously about Paul Simon's, the way Paul Simon felt performing with Garfunkel. You know what I mean? Like it had to be because it's like Chevy Chase is coming out and he's getting all the credit for singing it. Meanwhile, Paul Simon's doing all the work in the background. That's the big joke, right? Like I always thought of Simon and Garfunkel as Simon and Garfunkel, you know, like they're writing these songs together. They're two schoolboys. They're two sensitive coffee house types whose emotions line up enough to write these beautiful songs together. But that's not what they were. Paul Simon was the guy who was writing all the songs and Garfunkel was just really this golden throated doofus. And I think that video is Paul Simon's way of just like, fuck you,
oh
Garfunkel.
Oh my God.
Yep, Paul Simon is Larry David. And Graceland is his Curb Your Enthusiasm.
That's a
you got a career one. To worry about, Matt. You can't talk like that. You are one of the few people who could potentially meet Larry David.
I didn't realize Seinfeld was such an avid listener of your podcast. I would have dressed nicer.
Shut your closet door, maybe. All right. Matthew, you said you may have a little time crunch here, so let's get into it. Let's get into these lyrics.
A man walks down the street. He says, why am I soft in the middle now? Why am I soft in the middle? The rest of my life is so hard.
Everybody knows the first line. A man walks down the street. He says, why am I soft in the middle now? Why am I soft in the middle? The rest of my life is so hard. This was the first thing that I started doing the research on the songs that made me so interested in it. Is the first thing that I read was Paul Simon saying that he wanted to lead with easy words. So he's basically opening it like a joke. You know, this is like a priest, a rabbi, and a minister walk into a bar. Like it's literally meant to be that joke. Like it's to put people at ease. Like he's thinking it through that way.
Yeah, it's from what I can understand, those lyrics are, it's simple. I don't think there's too much to read into them besides what's being said. He's just... I'm sad about my life and I complain a lot. And why do I complain so much? Which is in itself a form of complaining. Very Jewish.
It is. It really is. A lot of people have said this song, he said it's about a self-obsessed person becoming aware of his surroundings as you read through the lyrics more.
I need a photo opportunity. I want a shot at redemption. I don't want to end up a cartoon in a cartoon graveyard. I don't want to end up
favorite lyric. One of my favorite all-time lyrics. I want to end up a cartoon in a cartoon graveyard. I had no idea what that meant, and it was a relevancy. It had been 6 years since he had had a hit, which is a long time, and he had had such a career that he must have at this point been like, that's it, I'm done. What hope is there? What hope is there to come back 6 years later after a string? Do you know when Simon and Garfunkel disbanded? Was that...
Well, they did a couple of times. I think the first time for the first real like shift after they became famous was in like 1970.
Okay.
But they'd had a couple of like breakups before then because they, from what I read, they met in high school when they were real young and they had a couple of like regional hits or New York City hits when they were like 15 or 16 years old. Oh. So they kind of like made a name for themselves as songwriters. Paul Simon went on to work in like the songwriting factory. He's writing his own songs or he's, you know, arranging music and producing music for other people. And then kind of weirdly out of nowhere, a largely forgotten Simon and Garfunkel record, Sound of Silence, starts slowly sweeping across America and gradually builds to a number one, even after Simon and Garfunkel had kind of abandoned the project and sort of walked away from it. They just kind of like organically came out of the well, and that pushed them back together again. So they were breaking up like their whole career. Like they spent 40 years together just fighting and arguing.
Wow. Makes the music good, probably.
That's got to be the hardest part about being in a band or any kind of like long-term creative collaboration is it's very much like a marriage. Like as hard as it is to get through a marriage, as hard as you have to work on that, you got to work on your creative partnerships as well. And we've seen it so many times for so many people, it's just too much to ask.
Yeah, that's a lot of egos.
I need a photo opportunity. I want a shot at redemption. Don't want to end up a cartoon in a cartoon graveyard. Bone digger, bone digger, dogs in the moon. Far away, my well-lit door. Just a beer belly, beer belly. Get these mutts away from me, you know. I don't find this stuff amusing anymore.
Bone digger, bone digger. When I was a kid, I fell in love with that. I don't know, like I would wander around as a kid. Bone digger, bone digger. Dogs in the moonlight. Far away from my well-lit door. Mr. Beer belly, beer belly. Get these mutts away from me. You know, I don't find this stuff amusing anymore. So it's almost like the Simpsons joke. Like, it's cold and there are wolves chasing me.
I didn't ever expect to relate to lyrics like that so much, but the idea of like, I had my shot and I missed it, or am I done? Am I washed up? It painted with such vivid but absurd characters.
Yes. Yeah.
It's really impressive too. We talk about this a lot on the podcast. There's two different types of like singer-songwriters. Somebody has a story they want to get out first and then they write the music around it. But after I watched the documentary Under African Skies, and very much the opposite with Paul Simon. He gets the melody going first and then he writes lyrics to wrap around it. And the ability to do that and then to make them this good and this interesting, I just think is mind-blowing.
Yeah,
I told, and obviously not being a musician, but I think that's part of what makes it so good is he has the melody, he has it's the music that you connect to and the words that you think about sort of afterwards. But to be able to give them that level of attention, okay, they have to fit into the music the same way the music fits together, the words have to fit in there as well. That's a challenge that I think makes him the way a comedian will pare down a joke, like get all the extra words out of here. It's just what he's trying to say. I don't know if I said that very well, but that's where we are right now. But then it goes into the chorus, which is obviously my favorite, makes everybody happy. If you would be my bodyguard, I can be your long lost pal. I can call you Betty, Betty, when you call me, you can call me out. If you'll be my bodyguard, then I can be your long lost pal. I can call you Betty, and Betty, when you call me, you can call me Al. Did you read the story of where that came from?
I did. For the first time in my life, I understand what the fuck he's talking about now.
Yeah, I never had any idea. I never looked into it. I was like, it's just a fun chorus to have. But yeah, apparently he was hosting a party, and a friend of his brought over a French musician that he hadn't met before. The guy's from Paris, and you know, they have a good time. They have a long time. And as this French musician is leaving, he said, okay, thank you very much, Al. Thank you very much, Betty. You know, as if he didn't know who Paul and Peggy Simon were. It was just like, oh, it's just the accent. Like, oh, no, it is. It would sound like Al and Betty. It'll just be Al and Betty. That's fine. It's fine. It's like, how laid back is Paul Simon? It's good. Like, I was in my home for hours and doesn't know my name.
Well, that's what's funny to me is he probably was gracious and didn't correct him until he wrote this song.
Or maybe he's like that vindictive, you know? It's just like the smallest slight. And he's just like, I'm going to write a number one hit about this.
I love the confidence. The line was, it was nice. Sorry I have to leave so early, Al. Give Peggy my best. Betty. And just the confidence, because you ever like, I know this person's name, I'm going to say it, and you get it wrong. It's always when you're most confident. Always when you're very timid, like, nice to see you, Chuck. Like, hoping, because you're like 70% sure. And then when you actually like lean into it, you're like, no, I know the name this time. Nice seeing you, Laura. They're like, Laura's the other one. You're like,
I was emceeing a comedy show and I did the classic MC mistake where I totally spaced on the headliner's name. You know, you're just like, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome. And you can usually tell, but then usually when that happens, they like snap to it and you know, get the name right. It didn't come. Like, it did not come. She had to get on stage without having her name said.
Who
like,
was it? It did.
Sue Murphy. I'll never forget now. This is the worst feeling I've ever had in my life. I want to crawl through the floor and die.
Oh, God. I just remember I was hanging out at the Laugh Stop and my friend Carly was opening for Birbiglia. And he wasn't as big then as he is now. And she could not get it right. She's going to be a guest soon. She's the next guest that we have. And we'll talk about that some more.
I wonder if Birbiglia has that wonderful joke about people getting his name wrong. I wonder if she's part of the inspiration. The next comedian coming to the stage is Mike. Oh man. It's such a great joke.
She worked with Adam Ferrara and she was just, she had braces at the time. She's like, just getting Ferrara out of her mouth was so But yeah, we'll talk about more with Carly. Let's keep going with these lyrics.
A man walks down the street, he says, why am I short of attention? Got a short little span of attention. And whoa, my nights are so long. Yeah, that's true. I mean, obviously I'm a heavy drinker, and that would be what I would recommend. This sounds like a sober guy problem. I have a hard time relating to that one. Your nights are long. Oh, we got medicine for that. That can be fixed. Men have been curing guilty consciences and anxiety with booze for generations, young man. Step into the Irish boat.
Matthew, you're not a big drinker, are you?
No.
No.
I get tired. I'm not strong enough. I like coffee.
I remember this. Somebody was telling a story. Oh God, I think it was Owen Dunn. You guys were doing a road gig and they had picked you up and you had brought like a really healthy lunch and you know how garbage Owen eats.
Yeah.
They're just like, here's a guy who's probably going to make it.
It was, we were in Paris, Texas. Owen, we went into a gas station and Owen bought a Gatorade, Funyuns and sour strings, and they were all the same lime green color. It was like he picked them based on color. He just eats all three.
God, he used to have such an affinity. His affinity for garbage food used to gross me out. We did a Whiskey Brothers podcast one time, and he was talking about the time, I didn't know who Ariana Grande was. She was brand new on the scene, and I was just like, God, you just like her because she sounds like a Taco Bell menu item. All right.
Where's my wife and family?
With the side of Bruno Mars.
Where's my wife and family? What if I die here? Who be my role model? Now that my role model is gone.
Who's that about? What is
that? I don't know.
But I love the line, what if I die here? What if this is all I ever achieve? It's...
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah. What if this is my last day on earth? Am I leaving anything behind? Have I built anything for the people that I care about? This is where the song gets weird. And I don't mean to get all nitpicky, but every lyric website that I went to for this one had it in quotes, starting from why am I short of attention, but then ending, now that my role model is gone. But I think you could read it two ways, right? Because after that, it goes on to say, he ducked down the alley with some roly-poly little bat-faced girl, which is oddly aggressive in the middle of a sweet song.
I don't know what is happening.
Mean-spirited, yeah.
It's like straight up, like, what happened here? But it seems, because if the quotations are correct, then it seems like he's saying that his role model has ducked down an alley with some roly-poly bat-faced girl. All along, there would be incidents and accidents. There were hints and allegations.
I'm lost.
Why can't that whole thing? It seems like what they're trying to say is that his role model has disappeared with some roly-poly little bat-faced girl. But if you don't have the quotes in there at all, you could certainly be saying that your man who's been walking down the street this whole time has, finally decided that the only way he can cure this midlife anxiety is with some roly-poly bat-faced girl.
Yeah, I don't know. I will say that in some of the things that I've read on songfacts.com, even Paul was saying he does not care if his lyrics don't make sense to you at this point. That's not his concern. They make sense to him, and he doesn't really care if we don't get it. So he knows what he's talking about. Matthew, any thoughts on that?
Yeah, which is very Bob Dylan. It's the thing I have mixed feelings about when lyricists choose purposefully random lyrics for the sake of emotion. I don't care if they're very specific and I'll never understand them, but I don't like picking strong, evocative phrasing just for the sake of it. Just kind of like Mad Libs, okay. Strong words and images. But it gets the job done in this song. I didn't think too much about it, but could it be Lennon?
Oh.
John Lennon.
Oh, yeah.
That's a woman who stole him. People believe she took him away from prominence or took him away from his musical potential. I don't consider her roly-poly nor bat-face.
Bat-face, yeah. Roly-poly girl. That's so funny. If that's how he thinks about Yoko.
maybe spiritually that's what she is to him. But I do wonder who the role model is, or if it's himself, or if it's a relationship with Garfunkel. That lyric I can't make sense of, but
I wonder if
you hear the hate.
You do. Well, I
bat face girl
me. Overthinking it, because he does say he wrote this song while he was in South Africa and he's exploring a new land, and he's, I say role model, but maybe it was just his tour guide, and then the guy just bails on him to go bang some girl in an alley, and he's just like, now what?
I wonder if it's like, and obviously we're digging deep into things is kind of what we do around here, but you know, like this song is specifically about middle age. You know, it's about a middle-aged artist who challenges himself. He goes someplace to go see some things he's never seen before, and learns to react to that. Like, it's really unique. You don't see a whole lot of songs that are specifically about middle age. I wonder if like that's the reference he's saying, like, who will be my role model? Like, I'm 40 years old. I haven't had a role model in a decade. You know, it's like it used to be a staple of my life. I'd attach myself to somebody who's go, how are you doing it? I haven't done that in forever. I don't know if that's a natural arc, but
yeah,
I wonder if that's something that he's thinking about.
Yeah, middle aged. I definitely agree with that part.
I don't have any role models right now. I'm 43. I think my role models are now younger than me.
Isn't that weird? And that's also the thing about music is I'm grateful I do comedy, because you rarely meet any good comedians in their 20s. They don't get good till their 30s, 40s, oftentimes 50s. And you don't see much great music being made by people past the age of 30.
Right.
As much as obnoxious as 20-year-olds are, they write great music because they're emotional and irrational, and that's what you have to have to put that much passion into a love song. Yeah, I think as you settle down and become and sterile when you're 35.
Yeah, the only Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
I was gonna say if I was this age trying to write good music, I would be very fearful I was no longer capable of it.
Yeah.
I would definitely. I would totally agree with that. So then it goes into the chorus again. If you'll be my bodyguard, then I can be your long lost pal. You can't do it. You can't talk about the song without doing that. But, and also doing the dance, doing the Chevy Chase horn dance. A man walks down the street. It's a street in a strange world. Maybe it's the third world. Maybe it's his first time around. A little bit of Buddhism in there? I think so.
To me, this gets specific about Africa for me. I mean, I like this chorus. I mean, this. I still don't know how to, I have a podcast about music and I don't know how to talk about like the chunks of music.
Verse,
thank you. This is my favorite verse in this whole
song. I've learned all of it from Justin Timberlake. Take it to the bridge.
I need to listen to that.
He likes to label the portions of his song.
Yeah, I don't
know. Yeah. Take it to the bridge. Take it to the chorus.
Verse, chorus, bridge, that's it. Those are the only three words I know. I'm tapped out after that one. Maybe it's the third world. Maybe it's his first time around. I always thought of that, like that must be a Buddhist thing. Like, I think he's getting very high-minded about that. Like, the reason why this guy feels so out of place is because he's literally not an old soul. You ever talk to people who are into crystals and burning incense and things like that, and they'll tell you that they're an old soul. They're always an old soul. Nobody ever says it's my first time around. Like, I really believe in this shit, but this has got to be my first go around, or I'd be better at it. By it. Let's be honest. You don't speak the language. He holds.
I refuse to believe in.
Go ahead. I think we have a delay, but it's okay. I'll pause.
I must be delay. Can I restart the Zoom and just see if that gets us back in sync?
Sure.
For sure.
I think.
I was gonna say. I refuse to believe in reincarnation because I'm already bad enough about procrastinating. If I give myself multiple lifetimes to finish things, I'll never accomplish anything.
Nope.
We'll get this next time around.
Yeah, maybe next life. Yeah.
I love it. So all of your lives are you're just fucking around.
Oh God, that's what I would do. You're absolutely right. I would waste every single one of them.
I would have the cleanest house though. That's what I do when I know there's something pressing I need to get done. I'm like, let me just scrub behind the toilet for 30 minutes though, because I can't.
You would love Adderall.
Yeah. I've taken it one time in my life, not knowing I was pregnant with my son, and Charlie's a spaz. So
yeah, I've only taken it once today. So
what does it do for you? I don't mean to like sidetrack on Adderall, but I'm very curious about it. Like, does it? I mean, like I've only heard it as like a really, but it, I mean, does it work? Like, are you like laser focused in or?
Yes. Well, I have trouble where I start one task and I get sidetracked by another task and a side quest within that. And I never return to the original task. I open up an email to figure this out, but I see another email and I have to realize I have to book a flight. I can return to the original task with Adderall. It feels like I can reorient and find my priorities. And prioritizing tasks is very difficult for me. I don't do them in the right order or in the, in the order of most importance. And it gets me back into that. And it just motivates me more. And I actually sit down to do things when I take it. It's a pretty ecstatic high. It is a very nearly euphoric high. And the come down isn't very pleasant, but yeah. A lot like coffee.
The come down was bad for me while being pregnant. Oof.
Oof. That's why I've never tried it, because it just seems like it would just be so annoying, because I like being distracted. I like thinking about other things. And if I was just like, if I just had straight up tunnel vision, I'd just get so angry and frustrated.
No, you wouldn't. It's great.
Yeah, I would.
It's great. It's great.
You don't knock it till you try it. Focus is awful. It's awesome.
I'm too old to add new drugs to my diet.
Well, okay, before you. Okay, never mind. Go ahead. We'll get off of Adderall. Go ahead.
No. He don't speak the language. He holds no currency. He's a foreign man. He is surrounded by the land, the sound, cattle in the marketplace, scatter logs and orphanages. He looks around, scatter. I can't even read my own writing. Scatter bugs, scatter logs and orphanages.
Scatterings and orphanages.
Scatterings and orphanages. Yeah, so very, very third worldy. He looks around and around. He sees angels in the architecture. I really like that phrase.
So
spinning
nice.
Spinning in infinity. He says, amen and hallelujah. So it ends on a very happy note. You know, like he sees angels in the architecture spinning in infinity, and he says, amen, hallelujah. So even if he's amongst all these scatterings and orphanages, he's still able to see the beauty of organization, I suppose. And that gives him some peace.
Yeah, he has like a little religious experience there, I think.
Mm-hmm. I do particularly love the line, he holds no currency, because it holds such a double entendre.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. It can be very literal, but there's also obviously a symbolic meaning to it. And I think it's very pretty.
Yeah, he's got no money. He's also got no presence. He's also not. He's not there in the moment. Yeah. He's not current at all.
Yeah. Right. And the language mm-hmm. can be, you know, like an actual like English kind of thing, or just to speak the language can just be doesn't walk the walk, doesn't talk the talk. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And again, those. It goes from a feeling of insufficiency in the first, you know, two verses to this verse, it deals heavily with a feeling of alienation and foreignness. But this one comes from a place of joy and the excitement it gives him to feel out of place, I guess, or to feel alien.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think it ends on a positive note. Like he's come mm-hmm. out in a good way here.
Yeah, and you pay attention to the sound, how distinct the sound is. We probably take it for granted now, but bringing in that African sound, that South African sound, is the instrumentation, all the two of the musicians, as you probably saw from the research, are South African artists. This was a time when he wasn't allowed to be performing there, but he went there for the inspiration for what was happening culturally. And in times of great oppression, I think greater art is made. Yeah. And he seized on that opportunity. The morality of that, up for question, but the quality of the music created by that is not.
Yeah.
If you watch that.
It is a difficult question.
Oh, go ahead.
Go ahead. No, I think we're about to say the same thing. That is.
Yeah, well, I was going to talk about, because I watched the full documentary of Under African Skies on, and you can get it on Amazon Prime, and it's deep into like him hearing that group, like that, I think it's Stimela, I don't know if I'm saying it right, and he's like, he showed it to his producer, and they're like, we can recreate that here, and he's like, no, we have to go. We have to go there. We have to get involved with this music, with these musicians. And obviously the ANC did not want him to come. He did not ask permission. And they got really, really, really pissed off that he was there. And I was confused watching it. And I was like, he's not going there to promote apartheid. He's going there to try to collaborate. And, you know, the what everybody hates about, you know, apartheid is that, you know, you're trying to keep blacks and whites separate. And he's like, I'm trying to meld. So anyway, at the end of the whole documentary, he's sitting down with the people, the main guy who did not want him there. And they kind of come to terms with like, this is why I wanted to come. This is why I didn't want you there. And they forgive each other. And it's really nice. Should watch it.
What were they afraid? Like, was it the cultural appropriation? Like, okay, you guys came and you took our diamonds, you took our lumber, you took our land, and now you're coming for our music. Like, we're going to draw the line. Is that what the argument they were making?
No, they were boycotting South Africa because of apartheid, and they didn't want anyone coming. And he didn't ask permission, and he went anyway. So they were just
to help the oppressed.
Yeah,
yeah, to collaborate with the oppressed artists and the original people.
Yeah,
there. Yeah, so I don't think cultural appropriation was an issue back then.
No.
No.
In that documentary, there are people after the album Graceland comes out, and he's sitting in this small room with these people who are mad at him, and it's basically the Elvis thing all over again. This black dude's like yelling at him. He was like, you can't just go over there and take that style of music and then create it on your own. How do you not see that as stealing? And he's like stunned because it's not like he took it away from them. He brought those guys on tour with him. He puts those guys in the writing credits. He's like, this isn't stealing. This is a collaboration. So he had to fight a lot for this album and what he did there. I think everything, all is forgiven now and everyone understands it, but it was tense. It was a rough time for him, actually.
And yeah, both sides, you know, it's like people on both sides are angry. I was saying, did it have a lasting effect? Did bringing that type of music to global prominence kind of shed light on the struggles of those people? Because he didn't talk directly about in the music about what was happening there, but he said it created interest in the music, which created a compassion or an awareness for their plight. Did you find anything to reinforce that?
I mean, I don't think Paul Simon changed the world, no, but I mean... They did put on some great concerts that brought people together, and you know, that's always nice to see. So,
And he said when he performed there, he refused to perform for segregated artists. And I didn't realize apartheid. And I read Trevor Noah's book that it was worse than the U.S. because they studied what the U.S. did and learned how to do it more effectively. So what they accomplished in terms of separating people and oppressing people was, I think, outside of our range in modern American history.
Yeah, for sure. It was even more violent, if you can believe that. Way more violent.
And from whites made up such a small portion of the population, and we're still so controlling.
Yeah.
But the music's very good.
It's very Graceland's a great album. It really is.
I read a book I recommend to both of you called The Song Machine.
Ooh.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of the history of what led up to one Swedish guy writing most of the number one singles on the top 40, Max Martin, and the history of that.
Oh, I've heard about him. Yeah.
Yeah, going back to ABBA.
Whoa.
With heavy roots and Ace of Base, and then really settling into the world of Lou Pearlman, who is an Orlando-based producer who put together the Backstreet Boys, and then behind their back put together NSYNC without telling the Backstreet Boys.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Put together LFO, and I believe a girl band, and got charged with tens of millions or hundreds of millions of dollars Ponzi scheme. And he was this kind of a shyster who kind of had that way about him his whole life, always lying, always trying to pump up what he was doing, took an interest in music, but was not talented enough or pretty enough to perform himself. But one of the more pivotal moments in his life was he told people that his cousin was Art Garfunkel, among many other lies he told. And then at his bar mitzvah, Art Garfunkel, his actual cousin, showed up and spoke. And it somehow lended legitimacy and probably started that guy's music career.
Oh my god.
The confidence or clout to do so. Yeah.
What a great story. Holy shit.
And there's a documentary on Lou Pearlman as well, worth watching. But that book is one of my favorite books I've read in a while. Song Machine. I forget the name of the author, but
we'll have to maybe think about that as an episode, Ben. If we can cram all that into one episode, that would be great.
But they talk about a thing that Max Martin talks about is similar to what Paul Simon does, but not nearly as well. As they write the music, they get a good hook, and then the words are just tinsel on a Christmas tree. Just fit them on there so it looks nice. They don't have to mean anything. More of just the rhythm and the number of syllables, and do they have the right poppy buzzwords of love and body and baby?
Yeah, that's yeah. I don't like that. I don't like that.
I don't like that at all. I don't know if it's melodic math. I think it's melodic math.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I love math and I hate that.
So. My pop music mostly sucks. Sorry, JT, but that's my stance on that. All right, Matthew, I don't want to keep you too long, but let's go ahead and watch this week's 6 Degrees of Tommy Stinson with Jeremy Essig and see how he connected Paul Simon to the basis of The Replacements. Let me share my screen.
Hey friends, welcome to a very Saturday Night Live edition of 6 Degrees, where this week we're going to try and connect the show's most frequent musical guest to the bass player of a group banned from the show after only one appearance. To continue the Saturday Night Live theme, my initial thought was to use Chevy Chase, both featured in the Call Me Al video and briefly a drummer for a band featuring Walter Becker and Donald Fagen, who would go on to form Steely Dan. But then I remembered how much I can't stand Steely Dan, and I'm happy to have that conversation with anyone at a bar in between, say, drinks 3 and 5. So since I'm avoiding day drinking this week, let's look towards another musician, one who Wikipedia claims met Paul Simon on Saturday Night Live, his future wife, Edie Brickell. At the time of their meeting, Brickell was performing with her band, the New Bohemians, in support of their single, What I Am, which was all the jam at the pools of Zanesville, Ohio that summer. And though the New Bohemians still exists as a band 30 years later, Brickell also collaborates with many other musicians, including yet another Saturday Night Live mainstay, Steve Martin. Brickell and Martin would release the album Love Has Come to You in 2013, 4 years after the release of Martin's first music-only album, The Crow, New Songs for the Five-String Banjo. That album featured resonator guitar from Jerry Douglas, who the same year would also perform with Elvis Costello on the album Secret, Profane, Sugarcane. And 23 years after his own breakout performance on Saturday Night Live, Costello mostly reformed his backing band, The Attractions, calling the new version The Imposters because they included new bass player Davey Farragher, who was also a founding member of the band Cracker, a band who would, on their fourth album, Gentleman's Blues, feature bass playing from Tommy Stinson. So, Paul Simon, Edie Brickell, Steve Martin, Jerry Douglas, Elvis Costello, to Cracker, who unfortunately are the only band we talked about today not to have appeared yet on Saturday Night.
Whoa, that was a long way around.
Whoa. Did you guys know that Steve Martin had 2 albums?
I knew that he had 2 albums. I didn't know Chevy Chase was a drummer and that he played with Steely Dan. That was news to me.
That was news to me as well. I knew Steve Martin had went to music after comedy.
Blew my mind. Sorry, I'm trying to get us back to normal here. Get off my screen.
It's like Harris Whittles. I didn't discover his music until he passed. I was a big fan of his comedy. I listened to the music like, oh, he was in like an actual good band. That's not fair.
Isn't that crazy?
A network sitcom writer and also have music I enjoy? Ugh.
Oh, Harris. Oh, Harris Whittles. All right, Matthew. Do you have a guilty pleasure song?
Can I list 2? Is that okay?
Yes, please.
Yeah. Okay. Candy by Mandy Moore. I like Mandy more too, but it was that era where they kept replicating things that works, and Britney Spears popped, and they're like, okay, what's the format? How can we replicate it? They took Christina Aguilera and made her the next version, and then they found Jessica Simpson, so see if they could beat some more out of that dead horse, and then they found Mandy Moore, and it was fourth in that succession, followed by Willa Ford, was probably fifth in that succession. And weirdly, Mandy Moore, maybe best career out of all of them.
Unbelievable.
If you include film. I mean, it's another sitcom residual check, And the music video, by the way, please watch the music video.
It's great.
For Candy. It's early, like I was, you know, when you grow up in a decade, you don't see what what it will stand as. You look back at the 80s and 90s, oh, the clothes, the music, oh, it's very clear. But while you're in a decade, you don't realize what defines it. That music video defines it. The string top.
Yeah. Is her hair halter tops. Pigtails?
No, it's up in a bun with, I think, some kind of Asian. Yeah, I think she has like chopsticks through it. It's real wide leg pants. She's like 12 in the video. It's weird how much they're sexualizing her. Yes! Lime green VW bug. Yeah, they're dancing in a pipe, a skate park pipe back when kind of the skater boy era where skaters were like the sexy bad boys. Great video. And then I barely even call it a guilty pleasure, but the New Adventures of Winnie the Pooh theme song.
He's round and he's fuzzy. I love him because he's just Pooh Bear, Winnie the Pooh.
Amped up. It's like 1 minute long. Perfect.
I don't even
That's
think
the
I
best
can
one we've had.
Gotta get up. I gotta get going. I'm gonna see a friend of mine. That one. You know that one?
You have such a wholesome childhood. I don't think I remember that.
Well, listen, it's a good song.
I do remember the theme song of Jem, though. So, okay, I get it.
I don't know that one. I'll have to check it out.
I know, I'm way
Jem, old. Jem is fantastic. Ooh, Jem. Glamour no. and no.
Jem is truly outrageous. Truly, truly, truly outrageous. Oh, Jem.
There must be multiple Jem songs. Maybe. Or my brain has secretly composed its own Jem theme song and not made me aware of it.
Oh my gosh, that's awesome. All right, Matthew, I don't want to keep too much more of your time, but go ahead and promote
yourself. Can I geek out on one other thing about Call Me Al? I have another 15. There was that whole thing going through, and then the last, I don't know what it is at the end, the bridge, the breakdown.
Okay.
They're playing it, and they add, so that's, I think, a synthetic horn. And okay. the last breakdown, they add the real horn on top of it, and you can hear it amplifies the sound in a really pretty way. But it's very funny to me that you would have the synthetic version going the whole song, and at the very end, add the real thing on top of it. It's like I don't know what to compare it to, but just like having like use a couple splashes of synthetic vanilla, and then how about let's just add a couple drops of real vanilla as well.
That's so interesting. I'm gonna have to go back and listen now, because I did see in the research that I have it right here. The recordings were edited together in New York by Simon's producer Roy Haley, a monumental task in the age of analog recording, since in South Africa they rolled a lot of tape that Haley had to sort out with series of splices. So it's not like today where everything's digital and it's easy to move things around. So they literally have all these rolls of tape, and they said it was a pain in the ass, like all the shit they recorded there and then what they're doing in the studio back in New York and the way you splice it together. So that's probably why, like, maybe they were missing a piece in the front and then they had it for the end.
Yeah, it's like getting a Big Mac. I mean, like, yeah, one regular patty and one Beyond patty. Unholy union.
Well, it worked because they fooled me. I didn't even notice, but now I'm gonna hear it, and I'm always gonna hear it.
Yeah.
Right. Matthew,
promotion?
Promote yourself. Where can the listeners see and hear more of you? Especially you, Seinfeld. We know you're listening.
I will be at Salt Lake City, Wise Guys Salt Lake City, May 7th and 8th, if this comes out by then. Denver Comedy Works South, May 13th through 15th. And Idaho Comedy Fest, May 20th through 22nd. And I'm at Monday Punday on all platforms. And check out my podcast, She Does Stand Up Too, on all podcast places.
That's with your wife. I just called her your wife. I'm so sorry. That's with Laura.
I don't correct people anymore. 5 years, she has squatter's rights.
Yeah, that's awesome, man. Thank you so much for doing this. This is a really fun episode.
Man, it was great to talk to you, especially in the middle of this. It's going to be an exciting couple of weeks for you, man. Congratulations. Tell Billy Crystal I said hi.
Yeah.
I will.
And Dale and Chase. That'd be great, too. Yeah. All right. Bye, Matthew.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All right.
He's a fun guy to talk to.
That was a lot of fun. I'm so happy for him. So our Dressed Up Like a Douche this week comes from nobody, because for the first time in 66 episodes, we have completely run out. So, listeners, if you haven't sent us your personal misheard song lyrics lately, send them to us. Slip into our DMs on Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter, or email us at rockthecashbarpodcast@gmail.com. And while I'm talking about that, I'll just do a little commercial for us. Don't forget to check out our website at rockthecashbarpodcast.com. On there, you'll find links to our Spotify playlist and to our Patreon page. And if you want to become a Patreon member and support the podcast, it's like $5 a month, and your name will be put in a drawing. As you guys know, we draw once a month, and we will cover a song of a Patreon member's choosing the following month. So anyway, don't forget to check that stuff out. Next week, it's back to just Ben and I, and we are going to do a song that we have both been really excited about doing. I don't want to give too much away, but we're going to do Total Eclipse of the Heart by Bonnie Tyler.
And we're going to blow your mind.
We are going to blow your minds. This song has an origin story I still find hard to believe.
Yeah. I'm excited about it. This was fun. Thank you very much to Matthew Broussard. Go see the new Billy Crystal movie. Not just because Matt's in it, but because Billy Crystal's awesome. Anyway, thank you.
Vogue.